so much for that very eloquent and insightful account of my work, and in particular of the challenges that I attempted to address in the preventive justice book. I have to say, if I'm ever called upon to talk about the book, you're hired. So much better for me. Thank you so much for the invitation to give this lecture tonight, and thank you to everybody on the Max Weber program for this great honour. I really am delighted to be here. As has already been indicated, what I'm going to be doing tonight is talking about a particular issue, the use of the curtailment of citizenship rights in respect of counter-terrorism law. But as Ryan so insightfully pointed out, that builds very much on recent work that I've done in respect of the preventive role of the state in securing its citizens from harm. So I want to look at the ways in which citizenship rights, membership and mobility are being targeted, and give some examples of some of the more recent and, I have to say, very terrifying developments in my own country, the United Kingdom, but to make some larger comments about the challenges and the difficulties that those developments pose. So, I'm really bad at technology, so let's hope this goes well. So I want to begin by setting the immediate context, and then in a moment I'll give you a rough plan of how the lecture will unroll. But I think it's useful just to set the context first. And that is most immediately, most obviously, the extraordinary and, I should say, in many quarters, largely unpredicted rise of the Islamic State. And the problem posed by the rise of jihadi fighters who are travelling from many countries around the world to Iraq and Syria, to the conflicts there, and pose therefore a really serious problem for national governments should those individuals return to their countries and carry out the kinds of terrorist attacks that they're learned to do. So it's fair to say, I think, that across Europe, governments are under really extraordinary pressure to tackle this problem. And this map, I suspect, actually is already a little bit out of date. It's the most recent one I can find. What you see is that there are increasing numbers, very striking numbers, I'll give them to you in a second, of people who are travelling not only from the Middle East and from North Africa, but very significantly from across the European member states to join in the war that is raging in Iraq and Syria and the rise of the Islamic State there. When I submitted the abstract, the title for this lecture, I suggested that about 3,000 Europeans had travelled to become foreign fighters in Syria. Current estimates, and they vary, and people contest them, the current estimate is that that's closer to 5,000. So even in the time since I submitted the abstract for this lecture, the number has gone up very, very considerably. In the last year, the number of Europeans travelling to Syria has doubled, and that's not evenly spread. So in some countries, France is an example, the numbers of people travelling from France have tripled just in 2014. And whilst rather obviously the bulk of those travelling are coming from the Middle East and from North Africa, you can see on the left of the screen, sorry, I'm going to translate, you can see there that there are significant numbers also coming from European countries. And that's a source of very grave concern, not least because there's a fear that if they return, then they will pose both a domestic as well as an international threat. Moving on then, let's just think about the concept that Ryan introduced us to at the beginning, the idea that the terrorist as a terrorist has placed themselves somehow outside the body politic. And I think it's a relatively stable trend throughout the modern era that terrorists are thought of as somehow by virtue of their activities or their intentions or their plans to become terrorists are placing themselves in a precarious and qualified status outside the citizenship. The dominant conception since 9/11, rather obviously, of the terrorist has been of Islamic terrorism from Al-Qaeda all the way through to Islamic State. The idea that this is the development of an alien force that threatens national sovereignty and national security. say, and this ties in a little bit with some of the comments that were being made earlier, that it's not only is it not self-evident why we should conceive of terrorists as outsiders, certainly as we know, very often those who commit atrocities are, to use an old phrase, homegrown. Those who committed the July bombings in 2005 in London were all domestic citizens. And yet they are conceptualised and treated as if they were outsiders or aliens. One of the possible explanations for that, and it's something I want to explore in the lecture rather more closely, is that it's motivated, this characterisation is motivated by the fact that procedural channels of immigration law are less demanding, that the possibilities for coercion for executive action untrammelled by a judicial review is much greater in the immigration sphere than it is, for example, in the criminal law. What I want to suggest, and I'll come on to talk about in more detail, is that more recently, and in particular in response to this immediate crisis posed by ISIS, that recourse to immigration law has morphed into a full-blown assault on rights of not only of membership but also of mobility. And I really do want to focus in a little bit on the question of how and what ways mobility and rights of mobility are being curtailed in the name of countering terrorism. And I should stress, because Ryan reminds me of this, that many of these individuals are people who have yet actually to commit any terrorist act or to commit any grave harm, notwithstanding the fact that, of course, and I'll say some more about this a little later, the very expansive definitions of terrorism that are deployed, and the even more expansive definitions of criminal offences related to and conduct related to terrorism, actually means that almost by virtue of giving this lecture, I found myself foul of British laws on counter-terrorism, or could potentially find myself falling foul of those laws. And I'll explain why later. So let me move on then to, having just set that as background, to give you a brief roadmap of what's to follow. I want to say a little bit more about how the threat posed by fighters, by jihadis, both in Syria and Iraq, and as they return to their home countries, how that's conceived and what pressures it places upon national governments. I want to talk a little bit, though far too briefly, and particularly given the eminent political theorists at the present here, I'm really going to no more than skirt around some of the issues in political theory about the relationship between the state and the citizen and the centrality of ideas of security to that relationship. I do that really only by way of background then to talk about the developments both in immigration law proper, that is the use of immigration law as a means of counter-terrorism, before coming on to the most recent chapter in the story, as it were. And I appreciate that many of you here are specialists on citizenship, on immigration, on citizenship stripping. For those of you who will know and understand much of what I'm going to say, the good bit comes at the end, where actually I'll be talking about some very recent developments in the UK, which I think do change the picture somewhat and raise new and, for me, quite intractable intellectual challenges. And those arise from recent legislation, which goes far further than anything earlier in the United Kingdom. And then finally, I'll conclude just by saying a few words about what the implications of all of this are for justice, for efficacy, and cost. And I'll explain what I mean by cost. All right, so let's move on. We'll return to this question of just what the threat is. The threat, and here you have some varying figures, 3,000 to 5,000. I mean, actually, the truth is we don't know how many EU nationals are currently fighting in Syria. We don't know their plans. We don't know whether they intend to return, whether they will, in fact, return. The director of Europol, Rob Wainwright, in a really important recent speech, described this threat as the most serious terrorist threat since 9/11, the most serious threat that Europe has faced, and drew attention to the fact that across European member states there was a real question mark over whether the current arrangements, the current powers, provided the kinds of capabilities that are really necessary to target those who potentially pose such a threat. In my own country, the UK picked up on Wayne West's language to talk in a slightly more militaristic way about gaps in our armoury. And I think this just excerpted a little bit from his speech of July last year. We face real credible threats to our security from serious and organised crime, from the activity of paedophiles. I'm struggling to find paedophiles are in there on the list, unless there are some genuine paedophiles that are. Anyway, moving on. I think it's because I since I should say that, the very centrality of the idea of safe citizenship relationship as residing in the protection that states offer to their citizens through the provision of security, and the obligations that fall upon citizens, reciprocal obligations that fall upon citizens to abide by and be loyal to states in recognition of the protection that they are thereby provided with. And okay, so this is probably embarrassing, but here we have a quote from Bob, which I think captures better than something I could do, the core idea here, namely that the role of the sovereign state is, and the very purpose for which it exists, its end, the ground upon which sovereign power is entrusted in the person of the sovereign or the monarch or the assembly, is the procuration of the safety of the people. We could have a debate, maybe we will later, about the difference between safety and security, but let's not go into that just yet. I got into a debate with Jeremy Wolfman about that, and I'm still recovering from it. So, security lies at the very heart of the citizen-state relationship. We, to a limited degree, forego our rights to self-government, to self-protection, to acting as vigilantes, for example. We agreed to abide by the laws of the state, and in return for that, and this maybe is another too simplistic contractualist version of things, we expect from the state that it will provide us with security. But this, and again going back to the excellent introduction, therein in a way lies the rub, because of course the provision of security by the state endows the state with the right to exercise its coercive powers. And like many other countries, my own country, the United Kingdom, retains extensive prerogative powers to exercise executive authority in the interests of national security. And untrammeled the exercise of that executive authority, the introduction of coercive and emergency powers, in the ability to exercise this prerogative lies an unparalleled threat to individual liberty. And of course, again, I'm saying nothing here, and again, I just slightly wince in front of the political philosophers in the room, but I don't think I can say it better than this wonderful quote from John Locke, who says, "Men are so foolish that they take care to avoid what mischiefs may be done to them by polecats or foxes." I've checked, polecats are vicious creatures, apparently. But are content, they think it's safety to be devoured by lions. The lion here, rather obviously, is the state. And it's that irresolvable tension between the state as a primary source of security and simultaneously as an incomparable threat to the security of its own citizens, or at least to the liberty of individual citizens, that lies at the heart of this paper. And I think I want to go even further and to argue that nowhere is this tension more acute than in respect to state relations with those citizens whose beliefs or whose ambitions or whose conduct or whose plans can be deemed to threaten existence, the very existence of the state itself, that is, would be terrorists. So perhaps we shouldn't be surprised that in that circumstance the state questions an individual status as a citizen and seeks to respond by curtailing the rights and freedoms of that individual as a citizen, even to the point of risking rendering them stateless. So what I want to do now is to move to the second part, third part of the paper, I've lost track, where we look at the ways in which immigration law has been mobilised as a tool of security, of policing, and I'll come on to say something about how immigration law is being used as a tool of counter-terrorism. So if we accept that at some level the founding raison d'etre of the modern state is to exercise its sovereign power to provide security within its dominion, then the hazard of mass migration, of mass mobility, the hazard of organized crime and trafficking and of terrorism all pose a very significant threat to the sovereignty of the state. And it's hardly surprising then that the border has become an iconic site of security. The border is, if you like, the first line of national defence. Of course, I'm not talking there about a physical border, and there's a lot of interesting literature that I can't go into about the ways in which borders happen both within the nation state, something rightly pointed out, the border is everywhere, but the borders also are being exported. They're being exported, for example, to the very borders of Europe through the fourth item on that list, Frontex. I'm jumping ahead of myself. But the border exists not only in physical form, but also in virtual form. So transnational surveillance systems, data retention, retention of PNR data, passenger name records, Eurodac databases upon which that kind of information is stored, create, if you like, virtual borders, which we must cross in order to cross physical borders through actual travel. And I think there's a lot more to be said about that, but it's just worth thinking about the ways in which we both privilege the border as a site of national sovereignty. We import the border when we put constraints on people before they've even left the country, and we export the border when we join together to form the endeavours and the activities of organisations like Frontex. And this is something that we could discuss perhaps later, we also, in a way, allow the border to be everywhere by importing the kind of controls that existed once upon a time, only at borders, only in local locations of heightened security, into our everyday life. It's perhaps also worth noting, in the English context at least, that there is a long history of using immigration law as a tool of counter-terrorism. We lived for 30 years with what we now call the Troubles, a very British understatement. The Troubles in Ireland, namely the political campaigns of Sinn Féin and their terrorist wing, the Irish Republican Army, the IRA, who over the course of 30 years were responsible for the deaths of about 3,000 people, both in the Northern Ireland and in the British mainland. And I grew up very much as a child of the Troubles, which probably makes me a little bit more calm in the face of the current terrorist attacks. If you experience security alerts pretty much every day of your childhood moving around London, then you have a more chilled response in a way. But anyway, that's my point. So there's a long history of the use of immigration law, not least in powers to exclude, powers to remove passports, powers to detain individuals at ports and so on, all of which came out of the period of the so-called Troubles in England. And then, of course, in the wake of 9/11, there is a very stark reaction, in some ways can be a little bit of a imponderable reaction by the United Nations Security Council, where just 2 months after 9/11, in the Security Council Resolution 1373, they say, and you'll see it on the screen, that all states have a duty to prevent the movement of terrorists or their groups by effective border controls. Others, commentators Ken Roach from Toronto, has questioned why the UN saw fit to focus on border control when actually those who committed the 9/11 atrocities had all passed through border controls into the country legally. I mean, none of them were enforced papers. What we also see is the development in the United Kingdom of the use of recourse to border control and immigration law as a means of countering terrorism. And again, notwithstanding the fact that the 7/7 bombings, the July bombings in London, as I said earlier, were not committed by foreigners but by British nationals. So the obvious example post 9/11 of the conceptualisation of the terrorist as a foreigner is the stylization of the terrorist as enemy combatants, setting up Guantanamo, and so on. Belmarsh Prison in southeast London has been thought of for many years in England now as Britain's Guantanamo. What happened in 2001 under section 4 of the, the Anti-Terrorism Crime and Security Act 2001, Part 4, made a provision that permitted the indefinite administrative detention of any foreign national who was suspected of engagement in terrorist offences. Notwithstanding the fact, of course, there was no evidence that foreign nationals posed a greater threat, or any reason to think that the British population, British citizens, failed to pose such a threat. And that was a source of a very great concern and alarm to certainly to my lawyer colleagues and I, and to practicing lawyers, that we had in peacetime a system of indefinite and administrative detention in our midst. In 2004, in a leading case, in the Home Secretary, the SS, PhD stands for the Secretary of State for the Home Department, the UK highest courts found that provision to be unlawful, and they found it on two grounds. One was on the grounds that actually it was discriminatory. That is, it discriminated on grounds of nationality or immigration status, but without any justifying evidence by which to do so. And secondly, on the grounds that it was simply irrational, that it was irrational to target foreign nationals and to leave national citizens untouched. But I mentioned it here chiefly because I wanted to draw again on the beautifully phrased words of Justice Leonard Hoffman, now actually a colleague of mine at Oxford, he's now a professor at Oxford. And Lenny Hoffman, I think, put it very beautifully when he said the real threat to the life of the nation, in the sense of people living in accordance with traditional laws and political values, comes not from terrorism, but from laws such as these, that is the 2001 Security Act, that made it possible to detain people indefinitely. Now, despite this very clear and eloquent warning, what's happened since that case is a series of developments which I think pose a very real threat to the life of the nation. And before I talk about them, I'm going to talk chiefly about provisions in relation to immigration, to mobility and membership. I just want to, as background, as context, just to remind those of you, or maybe inform some of you, about the very expansive definition of counter-terrorism offences. And this is true across many jurisdictions. It's particularly true in the United Kingdom. So the definition of terrorism in itself is unusually expansive in the UK, whereas most definitions of terrorism actually require there to be some threat or use of force in order to coerce a national government. The British definition, again, in a typically understated way, defines terrorism in an act in 2000, so prior to 9/11, it defines terrorism as the use or threat of an action which is designed to influence a government. Now, influencing a government is the kind of thing that lobby organisations do, that political protesters do, that activists of various sorts do. And if I was giving a different lecture, which I'm tempted to, then I would be able to put in front of you a whole string of individuals who have fallen foul of this definition of influencing the government. I'll give you just one. At the Labour Party conference in, I think it was 2010, a lifelong Labour Party activist, Walter Wolfgang, who was a refugee from Nazi Germany, came over on the Kinder Transport, a lifelong member of the Labour Party, he was heckling the speaker at a political conference, and he was removed from that conference forcibly under the counter-terrorism powers and under this legislation. Just to give you the sense of the expansiveness of the definition there. Added to which, that definition then stands behind the extraordinary multiplication of criminal offences, which we talk about at great length in the book, I'm very excited about them, I'm afraid, but which I'd rather than bore you those of you who are non-lawyers, with the offences. I've tried to categorise them here. So offences which intervene at a point which is temporarily very remote from the commission of any harm. So we have now a provision of the English COunterterrorism any conduct in preparation for terrorist activity, any conduct, which in one leading case involved owning the map of the London Underground and some rather shoddy instructions on how to build an explosive. Manchi, the defendant, got 6 years for that. It becomes a criminal offence. Lateral expansion, already mentioned, belonging to, associating with, attending the meetings of, wearing the insignia of, remotely related terrorist activities, financing, training, maybe less problematic, publication, speech, possession. These are offences which cause universities, publishers, the owners and providers of websites, very grave concern, because we could, by permitting publication of an incendiary set of comments, we could forfeit out of those offences. And then omissions liability, a whole series of positive duties. The criminal law, for those of you who are not criminal lawyers, does not ordinarily go out of its way to impose positive duties upon us, such that if we fail to do things, or if we do nothing, we become criminally liable. Under the terrorism legislation, there is a whole host of positive duties, the most obvious being failure to report. Perhaps I'll just read up each one, just by way of, to give you a flavour. So under Section 1 of the Terrorism Act 2006, a person who makes a statement that is likely to be understood by some of those to whom it is published as an indirect encouragement to commit an act of terrorism, or being reckless as to whether such encouragement will occur, is guilty of an offence and imprisonable for up to 10 years. You can see, therefore, how a lecture such as this, read in a certain way, could be read or understood by someone. It is not in my power how you understand my lecture, notice. Could be understood as an indirect encouragement, or being reckless, perhaps I am being reckless. I said that in front of you because what I want to come on to do then is to do what I promised, which is to talk a little bit about the ways in which more recent developments have controlled immigration status and mobility rights and membership rights. But I ask you to try and put that in your mind, because it's these offences, these very expansive offences, that stand behind the powers I'm about to describe. So what I'm going to try and do, one should never create taxonomies, because everybody will immediately weigh in and show me that I have things under the wrong heading or in the wrong box. But I hope that at least as a provocation, or maybe it has some explanatory value. I want to come on to think under the following headings of the different ways in which rights to citizenship and mobility are being targeted and curtailed. So, to start then with the heading of deprivation, and I'll apologise immediately, however hard I tried, deprivation and deportation kept on blurring into one another, because of course the kinds of provisions with which many of you are already familiar, denial of refugee status for committing, preparing, instigating, accommodating that, or encouraging, deprivation of citizenship where, and this in the English case, is where deprivation is conducive to the public good. All of these are, at some level, not measures that are imposed simply for their own sake, but are imposed good, should say. But the breadth of that definition is, I think, quite terrifying to people serious. And it replaces an earlier and I think less problematic definition, which is found in many other jurisdictions, namely the requirement that the deprivation should be imposed only where the presence of that individual is, and I quote, seriously prejudicial to the vital interests of the country. There's a huge ocean between seriously prejudicial to the vital interests of the country and conducive to the public good. Those powers are, as I say, precursors to deportation and to removal. We have forms of administrative removal, which I'm going to begin to go into, actually. We also, all of those powers are, in varying degrees, are discretionary matters for the executive. What we also have since 2007 in the United Kingdom is a mandatory requirement that any foreign national who's been convicted of a serious offence, in the case of EU nationals deserving imprisonment up to 12 months, in the case of non-EU nationals deserving imprisonment for up to, in excess of 12 months for foreign nationals from outside the EU, in excess of 24 months in respect of EU nationals, they must be deported under the Borders Act of 2007. Now, of course, deportation, as many of you know, raises really serious issues about the safety of those who are deported, and not least the ability, therefore, of the deporting jurisdiction to comply with its obligations under the European Convention on Human Rights against cruel and unusual treatment and against torture. The way that that has been dealt with in the United Kingdom is by the development of a device known as the Memorandum of Understanding. Memorandum of Understanding are means by which deporting jurisdictions can satisfy their human rights obligations to, in many instances, really rather questionable and unstable and human rights abusing regimes. They can assure themselves of their compliance with the European Convention on Human Rights by signing a memoranda of understanding by which the receiving country promises not to torture or to subject to cruel or unusual punishment in such a way as to bring the deporting state back within the convention. The problem is that, of course, in many instances, immigration lawyers tell me these memoranda of understanding are not worthy of the paper that they're written upon. They are, in any event, impossible to police. They can't be policed because these are regimes which are, by their nature, not open to easy scrutiny, and in any case, the individuals who are sent to them are not easily able to bring about actions for judicial review or to appeal their position. And so, perhaps not surprisingly, the Privy Council Review Committee has pointed out that actually this is not necessarily a means of reducing the terrorist threat or the threat to British interests abroad, nor can it be deemed to make the world a safer place. And I'll come back to this idea that actually it's highly questionable simply that to send an individual overseas serves actually to nullify the threat. So let me move on to some more recent developments, and there really are two of them that I'd like to stress, and they are to be found in two bodies of legislation, the first of which is the Immigration Act 2014, which in provision under section 66 makes it possible for naturalised British citizens to be deprived of their naturalised British citizenship, again using that terminology that we've heard before, where that deprivation is deemed to be conducive to the public good, and where the Home Secretary has reasonable grounds for believing that the person is able to become a national So they don't need to be that much certain that this person could gain another nationality, then they can be deported. And I have to admit, and maybe I just don't quite understand how these things work, I'm still struggling to understand how, in practice, physically, it's possible to deport people who no longer have their naturalised British passport, but have no papers of another country. But maybe some of those in the audience can tell me how this is to be done. So I've talked about deprivation, I've talked about deportation. I want to move on to the next heading under the list. I've already mentioned it, just say very briefly. I've already mentioned the avowed commitment to statelessness, a commitment which goes all the way back to the Universal Declaration of Human Rights in 1948, and has been, and I could have carried on several streams, has appeared, that commitment to preventing and reducing statelessness has appeared in numerous instruments thereafter. As a matter of national law, the UK Home Secretary is prohibited from depriving of citizenship unless she's satisfied that the order, and our Home Secretary is a woman, that the order would make the person stateless. It is the case, I think, that notwithstanding the fact that Britain is signatory to those instruments, notwithstanding the provision under national law that they may not deprive somebody of citizenship. That is correct. I thought I got it wrong there. That deprivation under the denaturalisation clause of the Immigration Act 2014, I want to argue rather strongly, have potentially the effect of rendering people precisely stateless. So let me move on rapidly to the remaining headings in my taxonomy. Shutting out, under a very recent piece of legislation, the COunterterrorism and Security Act 2015, passed in February this year under fast track legislation, it went through in a matter of weeks. Section 2 introduces something called a temporary exclusion order, and a temporary exclusion order is an order that the Home Secretary imposes upon somebody if they reasonably suspect, and you have the language there for you, that the individual is or has been involved in terrorist-related activity. Can I just ask you to remember that screen in which I showed you quite how expansive and amorphous and extended, both temporarily and laterally, definition of terrorism-related activity is any conduct in preparation for. That could render something liable to temporary exclusion, called temporary, but in fact renewable, for up to 2 years, where the Home Secretary deems it necessary for purposes connected with, not even in order to protect members of the British public, so not even the core security function, but protected with. Again, this is an order with which I'm struggling to grapple, because the effect of temporary exclusion is to leave individuals stranded, to leave them very often in dangerous, unstable places, to deny their return, which for those states in which, of course, they are stranded, poses a security threat in its own right. Namely, these may be individuals who pose a threat not simply to the United Kingdom, but to other countries as well. And I think there's a real risk here of over-usage, of over-enforcement, and also of serious disproportionality. A person who is engaged in any conduct related to terrorism does not, in my view, deserve to be excluded for up to 2 years, renewable, de facto permanency. So we have examples of shutting out. We also have, within the same piece of legislation, examples of shutting in. There's a power under Section 1 for the temporary seizure of passports, temporary passport seizure, where that temporary seizure disrupts individual travel. And again, the idea here is that not only, and this is where I think we have a shift in emphasis, not only should we stop people from travelling abroad, sort of travelling from abroad to pose a threat to us, about that being stopped for people who are themselves seeking to travel abroad in order to engage potentially in terrorist threats. I should say that the original version of this section shifted the burden of proof onto the individual to show that they were not planning on committing terrorist-related activity elsewhere. It's now for the Home Secretary to show that he or she has a reasonable belief that they are engaged in that activity. And it builds, if you like, it extends the existing prerogative power to cancel passports, to refuse to renew passports, and so on. But it also has the power, very significantly, to disrupt people's travel plans, their ability to move freely, to exercise their citizenship rights. So we've had shutting out, we've had shutting in. The last example I want to give before I move on to conclude is that of what I'm calling internal exile. Maybe that's a little bit grandiose. I talked already about our Marshall Prison, about the provisions for indefinite administrative detention of foreign nationals suspected of terrorism. The United Kingdom also has a very extensive administrative detention estate. About 30,000 individuals every year in the UK are detained in our immigration detention centres. It's fair to say that about 60% of them are held for 2 months or less, but another 30% are held for up to a year, and 10% are held for more than a year. There are individuals who've been detained under administrative orders for in excess of 4 years in the immigration and detention estate. And I think it's an area of concern which is quite as concerning to me as the other orders that seek to shut out and to shut in. In addition to which, an existing power counter-terrorism measure, the Terrorism Prevention and Investigation measure, which I can talk about more if we go to, it's a form of quasi-house arrest. What it does, it says that when the Home Secretary reasonably believes that an individual has been involved in terrorist-related activity, which is prejudicial to the interests of the nation, they can impose upon them a form of house arrest. 5 years ago, the incoming coalition government removed, as part of that power, a power forcibly to relocate individuals on the ground that it was a contravention of Article 8 of the European Convention, namely the right to family life. So previously, in its earlier instance, the terrorism prevention measure, or TPIM as we call them in the UK, allowed relocation. In 2012, it was held that this was a breach of family life because to move something 200 or 300 or 500 miles away from home, actually much farther away, off the end of the island, but never mind, was a breach of Article 8 and wasn't, even the qualifications under Article 8B were not satisfied. Under the most recent legislation, the 2005 Act, the provision for forcible relocation comes in, and in the parliamentary speech in which it was introduced, the minister said increasing the subject's opportunities to move away from terrorist-related activity. I'm still, again, struggling with the idea that something which is a forcible measure can also be an opportunity. But what that does, of course, is to take individuals who may have done very, very little and force them to be relocated under quasi-house arrest, hundreds of miles from their families, their jobs, their communities. At the same time, one might argue, and I have argued, that these measures, not only are they overextensive and overly intrusive, but they're also, in a way, particularly inadequate. Because if something is deemed to be a sufficient threat to our security, then, and I'll borrow the words actually of somebody who was subject to a TPIM, he said, if I'm so dangerous, why are they allowing me to be out here among people? Because although it's a form of house arrest, compliance with convention requires that the TPIM subjects are, for example, allowed to attend places of worship. And I'll come on to that in 1 second. So, could I just go backwards? I think I did. Yeah. So here is one individual who was subject to, well, actually, he's still subject to TPIM. A month before the end of his TPIM, when we were supposed to end, he went to the intrusive, the excessive and disproportionate nature of these measures, one might say that in the case of these last measures, the deacons at least, these are really inadequate to the task. So let me conclude. Much of what I've been talking about is not really about citizenship stripping. It's not about banishment, it's not about exile. It's about what the UK Secretary calls disruption. And here again is a speech from the Act that I was just talking about. That the powers within the Act permit the disruption of an individual's immediate travel. It gives a rise to the possibility of longer term disruptive measures. And again, I'm struggling with this on the one hand. Many of these measures are, I think, extremely intrusive on civil liberties. On the other hand, they are inadequate to the task of constraining the very great threats that are posed by terrorist or would-be terrorist actors. So I want to finish just by raising what I increasingly think are three interdependent and interrelated questions: the justice question, the efficacy question, and the countervailing cost question. Maybe they're all really just one question, you can tell me. So the justice question really is a very simple one, which is it just to render somebody stateless or otherwise to radically limit their mobility or to curtail their citizenship rights, whatever threat they are purported to pose? And come back to Rana's excellent observation at the beginning that these are in many instances people who have done as yet nothing but who are deemed to pose the risk. Is it just to throw people into what are effectively legal black holes so the deported stateless individual who may be in a non-human rights regarding regime who have very limited recourse to legal aid or legal advice, who has no ability to appeal the deportation, still less to bring action for judicial review? The second question, the efficacy question, is it plausibly effective to tackle terrorism by the practices of disruption, restraint, exile, and exclusion? One might say, as my team and detainee said, if these individuals really pose a sufficiently grave threat, then many of the measures I've been describing are not adequate to the task. But there is, and I'll go back to the very beginning of the lecture, there's a serious question about whether individuals who are not full birthright citizens, but dual nationals or naturalized citizens, or those believed to remain, actually pose a greater threat than do birthright citizens. And then finally, the countervailing costs question. Namely, that to the extent that these measures are regarded as discriminatory, as unjust, as illegitimate, or otherwise unfair, to the extent that they therefore attract adverse media and public attention, they may not serve the very security interests that they are designed to serve, but rather to exacerbate insecurity, insofar as deporting the individual, denying them their rights and mobility and membership, risks leaving people in very tricky situations, as I indicated, but risks leaving the British state, or other states that engage in these kinds of tactics, in the unfortunate, unenviable role of collaborator with some pretty dubious regimes painted by the association with those regimes. And probably tactics like this, I think, may very likely aggravate feelings of alienation, feelings of hostility, of isolation, which in turn feed radicalization and recruitment to terrorist groups. In short,